Hey guys, it's Hegemony here, and I wanted to share with my Immortal Wukong build with you guys. I get a lot of questions about it on a day-to-day basis when I'm streaming, and I figure I just collaborate all that information and put it in one video so I don't have to repeat myself. And it'll be informative and like a, you know, and I can knock it out all in one sitting. So first off, we want to talk about Immortal Wukong. Where did I get the name Immortal? Immortal comes from the usage and defense built around a 15-second immortal call. This ability makes you immune to physical damage, and it requires you to spend endurance charges to increase the duration along with other support gems and talents. I'll go over that later in the video. Starting out with the name Wukong. Alright, so when I was making this this build, I was trying to come up with a good name, and one of the streamers thought it'd be cool if I named it Wukong, because I asked him what a staff fighter would be called. And if you Google Wukong, it goes back to like ancient Chinese staff fighter. So that was like perfect for what I was looking for. This guy, I believe, is a League of Legends character that you guys know. He's mainly a cyclone based. I don't really cyclone, but with multi-striking and, you know, 360 surround, it kind of looks like I'm spinning. But either way, very cool name, exactly what I was looking for. So that's why it's called Immortal Wukong. Moving along, the gems and how this build evolves. Okay, so I pretty much made this guy self-found from day one of Nemesis with no help currency. The most currency I was given was about 6 alteration orbs, 30 portal scrolls, and 30 transmutes. Ox gave me that to start off with, and that's pretty much all I got. I didn't get any rushes. I got a very few TPs, but other than that, I killed all the bosses myself. So if anyone was wondering if this is viable with zero currency and from the ground up, and yes. Okay, so let's talk about the different phases of the build. Let me pull up my thread so I can assist myself. So if you go to my stream channel and click on the Wukong link, it'll link you to my thread. Alright, so phase one is what I call the phase without Bringer of Rain. It's relying on just normal chest piece, normal helm, normal gear, any two-hander. I didn't get my first staff, or I didn't start using staves until level 52. That was when I got my first one. So leveling up, it's pretty much a spectral throw. You can't really use hatred. I leveled with purity and clarity because my gear was dog shit. I didn't have gold rim. I didn't have all that good shit. Some of the key uniques that will help you leveling up as this build will be Worm's Malt and Slither Pinch. They're the leeching gloves. I think I have a pair. Slither Pinch. These. You're gonna struggle with getting a lot of int. Int is gonna hold you back on cursing and, you know, wearing certain pieces of gear, especially when you get to staves, because you need quite a bit of int just to equip a maelstrom staff. Let me show you. So the requirement is 113 int to equip, just equip the weapon, like the staff. And then to use like a gem that's 2020, it's going to require 151. 151 is the common top number for a pure int, dex, and strength gem. Heavy Strike is going to be in that same situation, 151. Blood Rage will be in that same situation, 151. 151 is a magic number for a pure dex, int, or strength gem. So as you can see, as a Scion, you don't get that many options. So as leveling up, I went this way. I'll show you like the path that I took. Maybe it's best I use a skill calculator for this. Okay. Let's index this. I'm gonna try to make this video as short as possible, or just efficient. Okay, so as a Scion, it's also important to note that this build is best done as a Marauder. The Scion start is not great. These 0.4 nodes are kind of lackluster, and this 12 HP node is complete dog shit. But it's like the best choice for something like in a hardcore or nemesis league, where life and survivability is paramount to the build. So I chose to go out like this. The build, in the end, will pretty much touch the Marauder start, and I'll show you what I mean. Okay, so as you can see, the end result of high level, I end up being a Marauder at the beginning. So for me to drop these four nodes to go elsewhere is more advantageous than these starting nodes. So I'd rather be a Marauder, but at the time it was like Scion hype, new class, you know, I wanted to, you know, stare at a chick and, you know, whatever. So I did end up making a Scion. I regret it now. So if you were deciding on making this build, please, please, please decide to go Scion. Marauder. Okay, so I went out like this, went down, got these Scion life nodes, or Path of the Warrior. And I believe I got this 12 life node, and then I just left this alone. This pretty much stayed static. I moved my way towards Resolute Technique. That's pretty much how I went at first. I moved down into here because I was really, really struggling with int. Now, if you have good gear or Worm's Malt or something, I didn't have any of that shit because I was pretty much self-found. Probably won't need to pick up these int nodes so early. And I think I even went to Armor Mastery. Went down like this. Went down like that. I'm not sure. I think I might have stopped at Troll's Blood. Then I went out. Picked up my first endurance charge, so I was rocking 4. Didn't really get that yet. Started working my way to Bloodless, or Blood Drinker, and these two life nodes. Went down here, went to Iron Grip right after that. After Iron Grip, I made my way down to my next endurance charge. And by this time, I'm not using Immortal Call. It's not very effective to use at this point. I'm mainly just walking around with like no armor and just endurance charges, and the endurance charge duration was huge. After I picked up this, my resistances were very weak. I got these life nodes, got diamond flesh, and then I pretty much left the side alone for a while. Alright, so phase one was done. Once I didn't need these int nodes, I connected like this, dropped these, and then started my way up the Templar route. Okay, so there's two ways to get to Templar. One is a long way that goes in this area. It's a longer travel. And since I needed a Dex node, it's still the same base. You still have to go up two, and it's still up two. This is gonna be a shared node, so that doesn't even count as an expense. I started to go up into here, get discipline and training. Again, I'm just numbing up all the life nodes. This is I think the first damage node that I picked up, aside from like maybe what you would call Path of the Warrior, since it's 20 strength and 12 physical. This was the next damage node that I picked up. So I'm just relying on gear to give me my damage output. Alright. After I got Path or Enforcer, I went up towards this other endurance charge and I got that duration. Once I got that duration, I went up to get these extra life nodes, athleticism. So already I'm sitting pretty good on life regen, life, and damage not so hot. But I think around this time I started to hit Merciless. What is this? No, this is totem damage. Ignore that. There's a misclick, and this is a misclick. All right, so the tree started to look like this. leveling up. Then I got Elemental Adaptation. I was still running Purity and Clarity, because Clarity, I didn't have enough regen and enough mana leech. You're gonna have to play that by ear, on what you need. You may never need to use Purity, you may never need to use Clarity, but in a new league, more than likely you'll need to use those items or those auras. So once I didn't need the dex anymore, I went up this way to pick up the strength, and I dropped these two. So you can see how these connect and stuff. And then when I finished athleticism, that opened up the option to go up this way and drop these two. This is essentially the same thing. You won't touch these nodes. These are like phase 3 nodes. But you won't touch those, but it just gets you adjacent to them, you know, if you choose to do that. Okay, so my tree ended up looking something like, I still have the dex nodes. I'll go back to the dex nodes for now, and then I'll show how I set up for phase 3. After that, got this int node that was definitely necessary. And then I got these 3%, 12%, and 10% block chance. So 13% block chance from 3 nodes and 12% damage. That is insane. One of the best benefits to using a staff are the defenses it gives you for the implicit mod. People that use swords are usually resolute technique. You have 30% increased accuracy implicit mod that you waste, that most people will just waste. But on a staff, 18% block chance goes a long way when you talk about defense. Not to mention, staves have the highest crit chance out of all the two-handers. Axes don't even have an implicit. They just do raw, hardcore damage. So if I was maybe something like axes or something, I might consider, you know, doing that on a standard league or whatever. Or if you have an unlimited currency base and you can get combs and 10k HP like all those top mappers have, you know, then that'd probably be more viable. But at the moment, I'm sticking on defense. I picked up these staff nodes. Then I started to work my way. So you have two options. You can either get battle staff and training, which incorporates 12% staff damage, 6 here, 2 attack speed here, 12% here, and 24% here with block chance. So you're going to get 4% more block chance, but it's quite the investment to get to these 4%. But this will give you a good damage boost. Also, you have the option of going into duelist. So the weakest points you're going to get in duelist are these 3 points right here to get inside. These points include 12% two-handed melee weapons, 3% attack speed, and 10% melee weapons with two-handers. Not that great, but getting to Master of the Arena. Okay, so you start to run into a problem when you use multi-strike with heavy strike. The knockback, sometimes it would knock them back so far that the last strike would not hit. Getting Master of the Arena kind of eliminates most of those problems, and using melee splash. So the range issue, it's like a quality of life. Master of the Arena is a godsend for this build. After I got Master of the Arena, I think I went across acceleration to get more dex and attack speed. After that, I went up to get these life nodes, 8%, 12%, and 1% life regen. So I'm sitting on really good life regen within the tree for very few points spent. The only point that I really, really regret is getting the starting Scion life node. Also, this is a great note here. This one point right here is 6% life, 12% armor. While I don't have much armor right now, passively, you can see how much armor I have. 1688 with a 16% reduction. With 7 endurance charges, it's 45% reduction. But since I have nodes like Faith and Steel, Armor and Energy Shield, and Armor and Life, when I pop a Granite, my defenses go even crazier. Okay, 9,674. So this is important to note, that I use a Granite with extra armor because it multiplies it when you use the flask. So that's the time you need it. So in the interim, I'm using, when I don't have endurance charges, I use a granite flask. So if I see Roas, shield charters, anything that's coming in hot with, you know, substantial physical damage, and I'm not ready to engage, and by that I mean I don't have enough endurance charges or I'm not ready to immortal call yet, then I'll just run around in circles, use my granite or, you know, juke them until I'm ready, get that enduring cry off, and then that immortal call. Alright, so, okay, this is not supposed to be there. So the next available, or the next thing I did, because I was getting into maps and I wanted to be able to do half regen, no regen, I picked up mana flows. Getting a better mana pool allowed me to run vitality, so I dropped clarity and I used vitality. So I'm running a 60% aura of hatred and a 40% aura of vitality. Vitality is awesome too, because not many people run it in groups. And most people run the cookie cutter grace, hatred, purity, wrath, sometimes anger, sometimes haste, and sometimes purity of whatever. So it's definitely, it definitely provides some versatility in groups as of like what you contribute. But this is as far as I've touched in the duelist, and for the most part, it's going to stay like this. There's no real reason to move over. After I achieve that and finish this circle for damage and block, I went back towards the Marauder life and finished like that. Then my gear started to get better. I got some gloves. Oh my god, did that just all go away for real? Okay, well, I'll just show it on my skill tree then. I got some new gloves with Dex. I got a new amulet with Dex. And I, instead of going this route or this route, I just went up to the left side, prepared myself for these nodes. Oh, and these, this is what makes the build so nice. Are these buff duration nodes. They're 15%, 15%, and 15%, total of 45. They're also located, identical nodes, but for lower quantity, 10%, 10%, 10%, it's an extra 30. So if I really wanted to, I could get even longer immortal call. I don't really see the need, because 15 seconds is pretty damn long with a 14 second endurance charge. Also, skill duration over here, slightly different, but it'll achieve pretty much the same thing. It's worded differently. These are buff durations and these are skill durations. Since Immortal Call and Enduring Cry are skills, it doesn't increase Enduring Cry duration. We tested that out earlier and I was very surprised. I honestly felt like these set of nodes were going to increase the Enduring Cry duration, but it does not. Only the Immortal Call and curses and stuff like that. And that's what's also nice about it, is it does debuffs too, so your curse lasts very, very long. My enfeeble lasts 34.5 seconds. Let me keep this instant hot so it doesn't die on me. Alright, so phase 3 is going to incorporate this is my skill tree. How did that happen? Let's look at my real one, real-time one. So I'm set up for phase 3, and phase 3 is going crit. These 30%, 30%, and 80%. It's very, very efficient crit chance. But in order to utilize these to the fullest, you need to get crit chance on your staff. You need to get that crit chance, this white number. I can't use my mouse to point at it, but it says 6.68. Get that stuff above 9. Run with a group with conduit and you'll just be critting out of control. And the reason for going crit are status ailments and this blunt trauma, which is a knockback. So you guys are familiar with my wander, how I was such a fan of bullying and getting that safety. The knockback is just gonna like juggle stuff in my spectral throw, which is really, really cool. The status ailments, shock, freeze, and burn. Burn is going to help you against those pesky ES barriers, it's going to put a dot on them, and then it'll put the cooldown. And it's, and if you're running vulnerability, it'll make that ES recharge a lot longer for, say, a boss like Residence or Piety. Burn is going to be nice, really nice. It's not going to do great damage or significant damage, but it's going to be a lot of utility against aura, you know, the discipline aura in general. The freezing, okay, the chill. That's what's the hot ticket. When you freeze something and then you kill it, it shatters. And when it shatters, it can no longer be summoned, like a res by a necromancer. And that's one of the biggest advantages of critting with cold damage, is shattering them. Also, they can't be corpse exploded. So if you're next to, you know, wanders that are corpse exploding, then, you know, that takes that out of the mix. Just freezing in general is amazing. So as a weapon swap, or as a gem swap on a undead map, a lot of people dread undead maps just because you can have like 6 to 7 necros in one room, and it's so fucking annoying. So the way I combat that with my current build without having crit is I use a glacial hammer as a swap for heavy strike. There are a couple adjustments you're going to have to make with this change. If you look at the gem, let's compare the gems. Heavy strike does significant physical damage increase, 95% and 150 base. Glacial hammer converts 50% of your physical damage to cold. So automatically you're going to be doing a lot less physical. Let's take a look at the numbers. They're not 20-20 yet, and the quality on glacial hammer only increases the freeze chance. Or no, the freeze duration, sorry, not the freeze chance. Okay, so if I look at heavy strike, let's take a look at the number of physical damage I'm doing. Okay, this is a little confusing with melee splash, or not melee splash. Yeah, melee splash and multi-strike. Alright, so main hand does 325 to 619. And when I put glacial hammer in, 242. So suddenly, items like my neck, 2% physical attack damage leech as mana, is not going to feel as good. Also, blood drinker, 2% physical attack damage leech as life, it's going to be half as effective because I've pretty much neutered my physical damage. But I do so much physical damage with this, with a good weapon, that I don't feel it. If you do less damage, obviously you're gonna have a lot more of an effect on your mana pool, because I run everything out of mana except for two abilities, and those two abilities are Immortal Call and Enfeeble. The reason why I have Immortal Call connected to Blood Magic is because I never want to be in the situation where I'm and I need an Immortal Call to, you know, fight, essentially live. Enfeeble, it's pretty expensive, 70 mana. Like, you always want to be able to debuff a mob that's like crazy or got crazy mobs on it. Okay, so I was explaining Glacial Hammer. So Glacial Hammer will freeze even though you can't crit, because it has a chance to freeze on the gem itself. And it also will cull anything that has 33% or less. See where it says, if the enemy is frozen and is less than 1/3 of their life, they will shatter. That's 33% culling strike. So this is important to tell your group if you're in Nemesis, hey, I'm using Glacial Hammer, watch out, 33% cull ink, you know. So if a mob is frozen and you do get it to 32%, it's going to shatter and it's going to explode if it's volatile. That's why you need to warn people, because people plan on that volatile timing, especially melee characters. They plan to get the fuck out. And if you're making that shit die from 50% to dead because it's frozen, then they're gonna be like, what the fuck, I just died, you know. They're expecting culling strike to come at 10%, like from a wander or from a gem that someone has attached to frenzy or something. So just as a courtesy, tell your group that you're running glacial hammer and that expect culls to come at 30%, and try to back out and back off if they have a problem with it. Okay, so I've explained the mana issue with switching to Glacial Hammer, and that can be resolved by either running Clarity or getting better physical damage overall. Okay, so the gems that I have attached to Melee Splash, Heavy Strike, Multi-Strike, Added Fire. Okay, so in Phase 1 with Heavy Strike, I pretty much just ran Heavy Strike with Added Fire, and then I added Faster Attacks later, and then Multi-Strike came way later. And then when I got Bringer of Rain, that all shifted, because Bringer of Rain has an implicit melee physical, faster attacks, and blind. Level 18. So then I started to use Melee Splash, Heavy Strike, Added Fire, and Multi-Strike. The Multi-Strike and Melee Splash are just amazing as far as like map clearing, utility, killing bosses. I mean, it gets the job done, hands down. As far as moving Spectral Throw, so you either have a choice. You now, since you can't use a chest anymore, since Bringer of Rain does not allow it, you have to move Spectral Throw to your staff if you want a 5-link or better, or you can move it to your gloves and boots and run it on a 4-link. So leveling up, I leveled up as 75% Spectral Throw, 25% Heavy Strike. That means I was using it 3 times more than I was single targeting with Heavy Strike. I was just mainly Heavy Striking on rares and bosses just to kill them and put them down. And I was using Heavy Strike or Spectral Throw for everything else. But with getting Bringer Rain, the damage of Heavy Strike and the utility and the clear speed was just so much better with this 7-link, you know, quote unquote, that I started using Bringer Rain, or I started using Heavy Strike more. It was more like 75, you know, it flip flopped. I went from being heavily Spectral Throw to heavily Heavy Strike. So the problem was with the staff. Is since the staff is implicitly intellect and strength, and it's more strength than int. Okay, oh no, it's actually equal, 50-50. So that means I am just as likely to get a red link as I am a blue link. So I'm trying to get 3 off. So these hybrid ones, especially like saintly chainmails, are the biggest bitch to get green links, let alone green links with 2 red. So it took me about 700 chromes just to make this shit work in a 5-link. When I get this 6-link, I'll eventually want 4 green, 2 red. And I'm expecting to spend somewhere around 3,500 chromes just to get that. So you really got to make a choice of whether or not the staff is worth investing that much currency into just 6-linking it and then chroming it. Chroming it is going to be very, very hard. So prepare yourself financially for that kind of endeavor for moving from no 6-link to Bringer of Rain. I honestly spent 2.5 hours just shopping to make my gear work around Bringer of Rain, because before that I was using a helm with intellect and I was using resists on my helm and chest. Just making the resist work was a pain in the butt. I mean, it's doable. Some people can even go around this route over here to get the 18. I thought about going 18, 18, 18, and then plus 10 just to make Bringer of Rain work. But luckily, there was enough items on PoE XYZ that I was able to purchase, and I didn't have to do that. I did end up going from up and over to getting these 2 fire resist nodes, because, I mean, it's much better than dumping 5 points to get 28 all resist. And I didn't want to run Purity, and I didn't want to downgrade from Hatred. So, oh, and I had to pick up Faith and Seal. I needed another 8%. So while this armor doesn't really help me passively, when I pop a granite, it helps me a lot. So you can see I don't have Unwavering Stance, and the reason for that is if I have Unwavering Stance, this evasion rating, 1783, which gives me 20% chance to evade, will now become 5. Since the node says cannot evade enemy attacks, well, actually it might be 0 if you get that. I'm not sure. I know you get a base chance of to evade of 5%, but I don't want to trade 15% or more. Okay, let's just say it like that for what's it called? Unwavering Stance. I rarely get stunned, and if I do, I usually know how to deal with it. Same thing with Iron Reflexes. Converts all evasion rating to armor. Dexterity provides no bonus to evasion. I don't pick this up because I don't need armor with Immortal Call and Endurance charges. 45% mitigation with endurance charges, and immortal claws, physical immunity, so I had to get any armor. So I'm rocking around 680 life regen per second. So what I did was, my last three levels, I picked up this level, this node, and this node. And then I got another skill point, so I had three to mess around with. I unspec'd these two, and then I just got some more damage and live hybrid nodes. And some stun duration. Okay, so now that I've gone over that, for the sixth link on a staff, you want to be very careful. Couple options you have are physical projectile damage, which is 120% multiplier, but it should be, you know, easily negated by the amount of increase in physical damage. Projectile damage is all damage, attack damage, same thing. The 10% less attack speed is what kind of turns me off. I don't like attacking too slow. You can see the difference when I put in swap this for, yeah, I guess LMP. You know, it's significantly slower. So if I were to micro, you know, I'm pausing a lot more between hits. If I get more, like, if I get better jewelry with attack speed, or, you know, I'll probably consider it. I don't know. I'll try it out. We'll see how it goes. But another very good gem to use as a six link in a green spectral throw slot is Culling Strike. Where is it? 2020. So I'll get 10% increased attack speed, and I'll get 22% increased damage. It's only going to cost me 110 multiplier, and then it's going to give me Culling Strike, which is amazing since spectral throw is my secondary mode of attack. It's very useful, and you know, it'll get the job done. And then once I get crit and I go crit and I drop Resolute Technique, these 2 points, get into these awesome crit nodes, I'll most likely I'll use additional accuracy. It's not quality yet. I'm leveling one up. Where is it? This one will give you like around, it's over 1,000, so almost 1,100 accuracy on the gem, and then it comes with 80% crit chance if it's 20 quality, I believe. Yeah, 80 crit chance. And then for more accuracy, you're only 2 nodes away from 2 really good accuracy nodes that give you dex also. You get 10% accuracy here, and 20 dex, and another 10 here, and 20 dex. So if you're worried about accuracy and missing a lot, those 2 nodes should solve your problems, along with that accuracy gem. This is all going to multiply against each other. Alright, let me go back to my notes. Alright, let's talk about map mods. What map mods I do? I pretty much do any map mod, can handle any map mod. The weaknesses of the build are doing bosses that have minus max, or double haste, or boss damage. Like, this character isn't very built to handle like crematorium boss, firestorms very well. You know, you could get stun locked in a firestorm and die like within a second if you're minus max. While you can shoot from far away and shoot from like safe distances, it's still always going to be a risk. I mean, but it's not something that it's a problem that most characters share, is that fucking crematorium boss and Piety phase 1 fight, type fight. Other than that, everything else is very, very doable. The weaknesses are very common. I made this build before Wings of Entropy came out, and it really pissed me off because I was trying to make a very, very, very tanky two-handed build, and that build is so tanky, and it gets spell blocked, so it's like the best of both worlds. You get lots of physical and lots of spells. So the difference would be, if I were to run that with Immortal Call, I would run 6 endurance charges, which make Immortal Call 10 seconds or 12 seconds instead of 15. I would have less life and less life regen, but at the expense of 58% block chance and like how much is it, 75%, so 58 times 0.75, 43% and a half spell block, which is insane. And it makes you tank against spells, you're tanking against physical because of Immortal Call, and But the thing is, with the axes, you can't really scale that with crit and crit chance. And the spectral throw isn't going to hit as hard because it doesn't do as much main hand, offhand physical damage. So you'll be very strong with melee splash dual strike with a spectral throw combo. But you'll be very, very tanky against spells. And that was one drawback of this build. You won't get the sweet knockback. But I'm going to do this double boss museum, which most people would not even think of trying. I'm going to show you the strength of the build and running Immortal Call. So what I'll usually do is I'll usually milk up 7 endurance charges before I go in. I'll leave the adds up, and then I'll come back and finish them later. All right, I have 7 in. I'm going in, popping Immortal Call, and then going ham. And as you can see, nothing physical will harm me. I just sit here and pretty much just turret. Make sure that timer is good. The only thing I'm getting hit by is that fucking chaos damage. Whoa, 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 whoa. Alright, hold on. Bad example. Something in there is fucking me up. Alright, I'm guessing one of the rares had added lightning or added something onto them. So it's important to know that when you do Immortal Call, that while you may be immune to like titty bitches and stuff, chaos damage, magical damage, damage added as fire, lightning, or cold are going to penetrate through that shield. Okay, now I'm going to go to Lunaris and I'm going to show you how Bringer of Rain benefits this build. Alright, so I just pretty much, I tried to face tank it, you know, just outright, but something was buffing up the boss that was penetrating through my Immortal Call. I'm not sure what it was, I'll check it later. But we're going to go through Lunaris and understand why I chose to use, what's it called, Bringer of Rain over, you know, a 6-link chest or some GG rares. Let me find level 2. And if you're wondering, is this build viable in high-end maps? Yes, it is. I've done many, many maps with rip mods, vulnerability, phys reflect. Physical reflect is negated by Immortal Call and spectral throw usage. The reason why you want to use spectral throw when you're not Immortal Called is because it does very frequent but smaller attacks that allow you to mitigate them through endurance charges or armor. But heavy strike will hurt if you attack into a physical reflect pack without Immortal Call. Okay, fine. This is all right. Here it is. All right, so. We'll go into here. I'm gonna find some titty bitches. Okay, this is only one titty bitch. Okay, so now we'll notice how many endurance charges I'm gonna get and how easy it is to sustain endurance charges and Immortal Call. So one global, I'm able to get 7 charges, and I'm able to replenish this 15 second Immortal Call. On top of that, every 10% chance when you block, I'm getting endurance charges from these titty bitches. I'm not casting Enduring Cry. They're supplying me through this Bringer of Rain. Let's see if they can get me to... No, they can't get me there. Oops, switched weapons. That's not good. Alright, let's see if they can get me there this time. I'm going to reset it. Alright, so 1, 6, 7. Alright, so 5 seconds left on my Immortal Call. Pretty much free endurance charges that they're feeding me. Yeah, and also phase 3 also includes the usage of Ming's Heart. And the reason why is It converts, or it gets a person. Oh shit, I just crashed. Alright, well, that's a good thing. It converts the physical damage that you have and adds it as chaos. So it doesn't take away any physical. I shouldn't say convert, it just adds it. Calculates physical damage, takes a portion of it, and gives you chaos damage that can crit too when you get crit chance. Also, you can use Blood Rage with it to get free frenzy charges and then get 10% life leech. But you need good chaos resist to sustain it. Right now I have minus 20. That's why I get wrecked by chaos damage. Minus 20. Viper Strike, Jungle Valley. Most of those bosses are going to hurt. Once I get that chaos resist, a lot of these fights will just be trivial. Same thing with Labyrinth. Stuff like that. But you can see like the how easy it is to sustain, and you know, a lot of people dread the experience of, oh man, it's going to be such a bitch getting endurance charges. I hate doing it. But once you get the endurance charges to 15 seconds or 14 seconds, like the duration, it's very, very easy to just, you know, go around. And you don't even have to immortal call. It's constantly, I'm constantly assessing the situation on of how much physical damage is, or the potential for physical damage exists. If it doesn't exist, I may just walk around with endurance charges and just use it just like armor, like I had iron reflexes. 14 second endurance charge is not at all hard to keep up. And then when you want to, on a trigger at any point, you can hit immortal call. So what you want to do is say if you can't find any mob to cast immortal call to refresh it, you might as well spend it at the very last second. Because it's going to last 15 seconds and it's going to take you into that next pack physically immune. Okay, so when you switch zones, it changes. Alright, so I got from one Enduring Cry, I got 6 charges, right? Let's try to get these numbers smaller so you can see how much leeway you need. Let's do a 2 stack Immortal Call. Alright. 2 seconds lasts 5, or 2 endurance charges last 5 seconds. That's enough time to take down a lot of shit. So you don't only really need 2 endurance charges if you don't have to wait for 7. That's an often misconception that people have with, oh, I need to wait till I'm 7 and then go ham. No, that's false. Just take what you need, whether it be 5 and gives me 11, 2 that gives me 5. You know, you can get the job done with pretty much anything. This build isn't limited to heavy strike. If you don't like heavy strike, you can use dual strike. There are pros and cons of using all different kinds of different melee abilities. You can use ground slam, you could use leap slam, you could use glacial hammer, you could use double strike, or not, yeah, double strike. Not, did I say dual strike? I didn't mean to say dual strike. You can only use dual strike if you use Wings of Entropy. But insert whatever melee ability you want in your Bringer of Rain. Ground slam, conk effect, if that's your thing, if that's what you like, you can still do this with the staff, with block chance. You can't use puncture, can't use viper strike, any weapon you can use with a staff. And if you don't want to use a staff, you want to use an axe or sword, you can still be immortal with the endurance charges and the duration. Same thing like you guys see Ox, he uses a two-handed sword. And he doesn't have any block chance, so there's no real benefit for him to use Bringer of Rain, really. So because of that, he uses a 6-link chest and a nice helmet. But you can do it with any weapon. Wukong is a choice that I made because of the block chance. 50% chance to block. And I can increase it if I wore an anvil, but I don't want to wear an anvil. Ultimately, I want to get an amulet with crit chance and crit multi. But it's going to require my supporting pieces to be very, very strong, like 40 plus resist, because I want to be above the resist cap to where I can do LE Weak for free. I can still do LE Weak with endurance charges, but you know, if I have to have endurance charges and I have to be physically immune, that's going to be very, very sketchy, because I forfeit my endurance charges, which would be my elemental resist in an LE Weak map. Or physical immunity. So combine Sporkers with deadly melee skeletons in an Ellie Week map, and I have to make a tough call. Most likely the call will be just to back off and spectral throw from ranged. Okay. So yeah, if you tune into my stream and you're curious of how this will play out and different map mods, you can feel free to, you know, hit the follow button and you'll be able to see strengths and weaknesses. Pretty much, like, I don't really struggle with any map mods. You can do blood magic, which is awesome. You just lose vitality and hatred, so that's a damage and healing nerf, so it's not a big deal. Half regen, no regen, I do that all the time. And there's something else that I wanted to say. I can't remember. But yeah, does anyone have any questions about the build itself before I end this segment? We'll take like 30 seconds. Try not to make it too long for the YouTube video. I calculated with Ming's Heart. I borrowed it from a friend, and it increased my my heavy strike. I think 2,300 or 2,400 DPS, and my spectral throw went up. Wait, what's wrong with my spectral throw? Oh, it's got leap slam in it. My spectral throw went up like 700. Alright, no questions, so that's going to conclude this this build showcase. I'll do some more on my other characters later at a later time. Keep in mind there's an interview with Chris Wilson in mid-January. It's going to be a podcast with me and Ox and Chris. So that should be fun, and I'll see you guys later. Thanks.